Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Before we get to Merrill Reese, the play-by-play call today, which Merrill's appeared on many times, but this time it is Utah basketball.
Minute 25, 13 on the shot clock. Allen gets into the lane. Timmy Allen, floater up and good! On the baseline, Utah by 2, 68-66.
Yep. Beat Kentucky, and that was in Vegas. And, in fact, I was on his show a year and a half ago when Penn State was in the NIT. Well, it's interesting. I talked to Patrick Chambers, Penn State's basketball coach, earlier today. And he said, hey, what do you have coming up on the show? And I said, Merrill Reese. He says, Merrill Reese? He says, tell him hi from a Delco guy. So Penn State's ranked 23rd. They have Central Connecticut tomorrow night, but he wanted to make sure I said hi to you. Merrill, brilliant as always during the course of this season. Thanks so much for joining us.
It's always good to be on with you. You know how much I enjoy listening to you.
Well, I appreciate that. That means a lot to me, more than you know. For some Eagle fans, this has been one of those frustrating rides along the way, yet they have a chance to get to the front of the division with this one. Starting with the middle of the second half of the Giants game, have you seen a different Eagles team?
I've seen a different Carson Wentz. People always say that the truly great quarterbacks have the ability to lift the team up by the bootstraps and carry them to a win, come from behind wins in the final seconds. And that's what we have seen Carson Wentz do in consecutive games. He's been amazing.
And what's made it happen for him? I mean, because the receiver merry-go-round for him has not been easy. So what has kicked in for him? Is it just that innate ability he has to sense the money's on the table and I have to make it get it done?
I think that's it. I think there are other factors, of course. I think they've got some great work from Miles Sanders, the great Penn Stater, and they've got great work from a little guy by the name of Boston Scott. In the Giants game, he was the spark plug who came off the bench when Miles went off with the cramp and they couldn't catch him. So he was a big factor. And then there's a little receiver. Well, he's not so little. He's probably in the 5'11 category, who was a quarterback at the University of Houston by the name of Greg Ward, who finally made his way onto the field. And he's been a factor because they lost Alshon Jeffery, and Aguilar has been out for a bunch of weeks. And Mac Hollins got released. And J.J. Arcega-Whiteside, who was also drafted in the second round, really hasn't made an impact yet. So they've needed these guys to step up, and they have.
I have to ask you about Miles Sanders, and then we'll get to Austin in a moment. But what kind of growth and maturity have you seen in Miles Sanders' game from September to December?
Well, the biggest difference I saw was that when he first began, first of all, he was impressive in OTAs. He was impressive in training camp. But when the season began, the bell cow back, if there is such a thing, was Jordan Howard. And then that's right. Miles was the change of pace. And then his role became a little more defined, and I started to call them, not that it's original, but they were thunder and lightning, with Miles being the lightning. But he did what he was able to do in college, and you saw him every week, where his speed and explosiveness would get him outside. But in the NFL, there's not much outside very often, and he had to learn that he had to be patient and wait and hide behind blockers and wait for there to be a sliver of daylight and then burst through. And if there was nothing there, so be it. But he was trying to make plays and run away from people, and in the NFL, you really can't do that. And he became more and more accustomed to what the offensive line was doing. He has a great running back coach in Deuce Staley, who has been through all of these wars. And plus, he's a very mature guy, Steve, as I'm sure you know. He said, I tweeted the other night, I just tweeted about Miles Sanders. I said, The Eagles struck gold in the second round of the draft. Here is a guy who has a great passion for playing football at its highest level, and he does. And aside from all of that, he is a very down-to-earth guy and a very likable guy. He's not all flash off the field. He's just a nice guy to be around.
Yeah, that's spot on. That's the Miles Sanders I know. And look, and his mom has meant so much to him. Mm-hmm. And he wants to make her proud all the time. That's a big deal to him. And he really is that humble, which is good. And being behind Jordan Howard, he was behind Saquon Barkley for 2 years here, and he was smart enough to look around the room and say, you know what? If I bide my time, I'll eventually be the guy.
Yeah, I said to him, I couldn't understand how Pitt ever let him escape and go to Penn State. I mean, he, with all the great players that have been at Pitt over the years, with Tony Dorsett and, you know, Dan Marino and all those, how do you let a guy like Miles Sanders escape? But he said he had to. He said he needed a change of culture, and coming up the Happy Valley was the thing that changed his life, let alone football.
Well, yeah, I got to ask you now about the defensive part. Let's start with the secondary. Has this been a case of where injuries again have ruled the roost for the Eagles as to how they've had to play in the secondary?
I think you're right early. I think early on, Ronald Darby was out for a while. Then Jalen Mills, it took him a long time to come back from an injury that he suffered in Jackson, actually in London against Jacksonville last year. I mean, he missed more than the first half of the season before he made his way onto the field. Cravon LeBlanc, who helped them last year, still isn't back. The two safeties have been okay. Avante Maddox, you'll remember, got hurt at the end of the Green Bay game, and he's a terrific player from Pitt, by the way. And he missed a lot of the season, and it just took them a while to get back. But now they're back. And they're still not stopping people, not well enough. They've been burned by rookie. Well, they were burned by the rookie in the Giants game. And then this week they were burned again by Terry McLaurin, who had hurt them in the opening game of the season. He just ran away from them. I personally believe that they're better than that. I personally believe that the key to having good play by the secondary starts with the pass rush, and I don't think the pass rush has been good enough. It better be good enough this week. That's all I'm saying. They cannot allow Dak Prescott to stand back there and locate Amari Cooper, Michael Gallup, Randall Cobb, or the result will not be a good one.
And that goes back to the first one. Well, what schematically or execution-wise must change from game one, Dallas, to now this game at the Link?
Well, I don't know schematically that there has to be a change. What has to change is, you will remember in that game, or maybe you were probably busy concentrating on the Nittany Lions, but what happened in that game was the Eagles lost the ball on their first two possessions, and they fell behind very, very quickly. They can't afford to fall behind the Cowboys. It's one thing to try to come back against the Giants and against the Redskins, which they did successfully, but if they go down 14-0 to the Cowboys, it's going to be a long afternoon. They've got to practice ball security. Carson Wentz has dropped the ball, fumbled it too many times. Been great in terms of his interceptions to touchdown ratio. I mean, I think he's like 25 touchdown passes and 7 interceptions. But as far as fumbling the football, he's lost 7 fumbles, 6 or 7 fumbles already this season, and you can't do that. So don't give the ball away. That's what has to change. Ball security, and play the way in the first quarter that they've played in the fourth quarter recently.
Right, because look, they played the entire game in Arlington the first time uphill. That's a hard way to play.
Oh, you can't do that in Arlington. And you know what? You can't do that even at the Link, not against the Cowboys. Although, here's what it makes me, we look at the Cowboys on paper, and their wide receiver core is one of the best in football and way better than the Eagles in its present state. And you look at Zeke Elliott, He's as good as any back in the National Football League. And while I think the world of Miles Sanders, it's going to take a while to match a Zeke Elliott or a Saquon Barkley. But I'll tell you what, Miles is certainly doing a very good job. But when you look at this team, they are deep. Their linebackers are so good. I mean, talking about Penn State again, Sean Lee, look how good yeah. he is. And Van Esch has been tremendous, although he's been injured. I don't know what his status is yet for this week. But they've got so much talent on that team. And Dak Prescott, they're talking about him having a problem with his shoulder right now. You know what? He's going to be out there even if he has to throw with his feet. So he does everything right. So this team must put constant pressure on Dak Prescott. But the thing that makes me feel a little bit better about their chances is when I go through the season, here's what I see. Eagles beat the Packers. Cowboys lost to the Packers. Mm-hmm. Eagles beat the Jets. Cowboys lost to the Jets. Eagles beat the Bills. Cowboys lost to the Bills. Eagles beat the Bears. Cowboys lost to the Bears. Now, the Cowboys did beat Miami, and the Eagles lost to Miami. I still don't understand why or how, because I think you and me and nine of our friends could probably beat the Dolphins. Yeah. So, I mean, they're a terrible football team, and yet the Eagles took a 14-point lead in the second half and then fell apart. So I think hopefully that was an aberration. But the comparative scores really favor the Eagles.
They do, and the Cowboys I have found – And I did watch the first Cowboys-Eagles game because I think that was a must-see. You had to see that game. I found the Cowboys to be an absolute mystery. I don't get it. I don't get why they are... You know, I watched the Buffalo game. Dick Girardi and I watched it over at Dick's house on Thanksgiving. And we just sat there and looked at each other. How can they fall apart like this? Because, I mean, we were rooting for Buffalo, but...
sure. And so was every Eagles fan. But yeah. But they do have the propensity to look like world beaters one week and egg beaters the next. I mean, yeah. they before winning last week, and they pounded the Rams, before that game, they had lost three in a row. So right. Who knows? There are a lot of faces of the Dallas Cowboys, and who knows what's going on with Jason Garrett. I mean, his head coaching tenure seems to be on life support at this point, even though Jerry Jones looks at him almost like a son. But and here, I really believe, Steve, that Doug Peterson is one of the best coaches I've ever been around.
I agree.
He is that good. Players look up to him, but they don't mess around. Because he has another side to him where he can peel the paint off the ball. But he's a player's coach. He's been through all that they go through. I think he's an excellent play caller. And I think that you rarely see them waste a timeout. You rarely see them waste a challenge. His play calling is, I think it's excellent. I think he's one of the best coaches I've ever been around.
Yeah, you can see the respect he has on the sideline. You can see that, and you're around it. You know it. You know, he's got respect. And then that part that you were talking about, it's something that you and I have talked about before. There's certain people that have, quote, a feel for the game. Doug Peterson has a feel for the game. And I think it's a superior feel for the game.
Oh, he does. He really does. And I'm a big Andy Reid fan. To be about sure. around Andy for 14 years, you have to be, because he's a wonderful guy, a terrific coach. I mean, look what he's doing in Kansas City. But once that game begins, I think Doug is more of a quick-twitch decision-maker. Andy wasted too many timeouts and rarely had any left at the end of the game. And I just think Doug reacts more quickly in making adjustments. And that doesn't mean that I don't think Andy's terrific. But I think Doug is, once that game begins, I think Doug is one of the sharpest they've ever been around.
See, I feel like he's thinking a couple moves ahead.
Oh, he is. He is.
And that's why I think he makes the quicker decisions.
Oh, he's absolutely amazing to be around. And he's always kidding. I said to him last week, I said, boy, that was some stretch in the fourth quarter with Carson hitting 11 passes in a row. He said, and the play calling? And the play calling? and we laughed about it because, you know, Doug is the last guy who looks for credit. Right. So we're always teasing Eddie. But he's so easy to be around. Most coaches and most human beings, you know how volatile it is in the NFL, where you go from the town loving you one day after a win, and the next day they want to run you out of town when you blow one like they did in Miami. But the thing about Doug is, he is the same after a win like this week's against the Redskins as he was the day after the loss against the Dolphins. He doesn't change. He puts it behind him and he moves on. And he concentrates on today and tomorrow, not yesterday. And that's a very important quality for a coach to have.
Yeah, the down-to-earth, no-ego people are like that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You and I have been around a lot of really great down-to-earth, no-ego people. And, you know, you can see qualities of that in somebody like that. And you say, yeah. And that's who he is.
You know, I'm not a controversial guy, so I don't like to criticize people, but I think
I'm the same
team,
way. I'm the same way.
This team, but I'm going to do it. This team went from the single worst communicator I've ever been around in Chip Kelly to Doug Peterson, who's just a phenomenal teacher and communicator.
In fact, I will quote you loosely from the show, but pretty close. That was interesting that you walked in the office the day after Chip was removed. And he said, you said, Steve, normally there you'll see secretaries welled up or some tears rolling down. He said, there was nothing like that in the office.
Oh, there were
that told me everything.
I mean, there was no communication. I had coaches coming up to me during that last year saying to me, Merrill, do you think I did anything wrong? Chip's not talking to me. These are guys on his staff. And, you know, I got on the plane. The best game they ever had was in Dallas on Thanksgiving Day. That was a game where Mark Sanchez quarterbacked them to a tremendous win.
Yeah.
And everybody was feeling great. And I got on the plane and I walked past Chip and I said, Coach, that was a fun game to broadcast. You guys did a terrific job. And he just kind of glanced in my direction and said, oh, thanks, and turned his head. There was no communication whatsoever. There was never any feeling that, you know, this guy cared about anything other than his schemes. And you know what? You can have the greatest schemes in the world, but if you don't have... He always talked about the culture of a team, but he never had any of it. It was just about schemes. And I don't care what your field is. You could be the most brilliant guy in the entire world, but if you don't have people skills, if you can't communicate, if you can't teach, you're not going to succeed in any field.
Yeah, and I'm around James Franklin and Patrick Chambers, who are a lot like Doug Peterson. They have that ability to relate to people all the time.
Let me tell you, Patrick Chambers, I know his brother Tim very, very well. Tim was the one, he was the producer of Miracle on Ice.
Yes.
And I knew Tim when he played safety at the University of Pennsylvania and actually came to an Eagles training camp as a free agent. And I did Penn basketball when Paul played as a guard for Penn. So I haven't met Patrick, but I know all about him, and I love the family.
Yeah, incredible.
James I haven't met, but my next-door neighbor, whose name is Steve Wagman, for the last 2 years, was the president of the Penn State Alumni Association, which is the largest alumni association in the world. I don't know if you've met Steve, but and after 2 years, you automatically move onto the board, which he is. But he said so many great things to me about James Franklin, and I think James Franklin just handles himself with so much class. Yeah. And dignity, and he appears to be the kind of coach that the players can look up to. You want to go to Penn State when they have a guy like that who does everything the right way.
Yeah. See, aren't you and I fortunate? We're fortunate.
Really?
We're around good people.
Yeah, we are. Hey. We are. We really are.
Yep. my friend. Great broadcast on Sunday. We look forward to it, as always. You're having, without question, one of your best seasons.
Thank you, Steve. The only regret I have is that this game isn't starting in 10 minutes. For you, it's Penn State, Ohio State. To me,
it's the Eagles and
the Dallas Cowboys with everything on the line. It's everything on the line. I just can't wait for this game to begin.
You echo the sentiments of all of us. And I know exactly how you feel sitting in a similar chair.
Absolutely. But it's always a pleasure to come on with you anytime you need me. You know my phone number.
You got it, Merrill. Thanks so much, my friend. Great one on Sunday.
Thank you, Steve. Have a very, very wonderful Christmas and a happy and healthy New Year.
Hey, Merry Christmas to you and yours, and Happy New Year as well.
Take care. Talk to you soon.
You bet. Merrill Reese, the great man himself. Merrill Reese, I don't know how many of you had a chance to meet him along the way, but, you know, we were talking about people who are great in their field but are just down to earth, no ego people. I was talking about Jack Ham, Dick Jordy being like that. That's Merrill Reese. Top flight, best in his field, and a down-to-earth, no-ego guy.
Yeah, I've read both of his books, Steve, growing up. I learned a lot from him to where I've been now, and he's been one of my idols and inspirations. So it was cool to have him on today.
Yeah, he's really – and when you get to know him, talk to him a little bit, you know, you'll like him even more. Hey, we need to take a break. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Here on the Steve Jones Show, News Radio 1070 WKOK. Back in Trillo here. We got Bob Buhner over here. Steve Jones will be there and back in shortly after Mel Reese. A big thanks to him for joining us here on the show to talk Eagles Cowboys ahead of what is a big game for the Eagles this weekend. That was some really tremendous stuff.
It really was. And, you know, it's the voice, too. Merle Reese just sounds so good announcing a game. There are very few people that have an iconic voice announcing professional football like Merle.
And believe me, they don't give you the greatest broadcast locations in the NFL either.
No, they're up in the nosebleed section, aren't
they?
He was
just in one of the worst that he calls it. He said in his book many times, and I agree, just based on Twitter pictures, and that's at FedEx Field. They sit you in the end zone, I think.
Yeah, you're low in the corner.
It's awful from what I've heard.
I did the Penn State-Indiana game at FedEx. I remember Indiana sold out for $3 million.
Yeah.
To play the game there. So we go in. Now, the Redskins booth is more around the 35-40. But it's not that you're in the corner at FedEx. It's you're low in the corner. So you have to come up with a way of doing it. And this really paid off for me when I did the Pinstripe Bowl. On the 50 coming towards you at FedEx, it's an easy game to call. There's no issues. But if it's the 50 going away from you, you now are trying to deal with a version of depth perception. You know, because you're so low to the field. And what I did was I came up with a method that as soon as the play was over, I'd look over at the linesman and where the linesman put his foot down. That's where I knew what yard line they were on.
Yep, I've done that myself, Steve. Anytime I do high school and there's no yard markers, I'll do the same thing. Or if I'm obstructed too, I always do that myself.
So when he did the Pinstripe Bowl, of course, we had the Yankees broadcast booth. Well, the Yankees broadcast booth is behind home plate. Well, in the Pinstripe Bowl, that also means that the Yankees broadcast booth, which is behind home plate, is also behind the end zone. Yeah. You're right behind the goalposts. So again, the same story, 50-yard line coming in. It was an easy game to call. But then when they went to the other one, I said, well, okay, what did I do at FedEx? Well, okay, when I was at FedEx, that's the method I use, and so that's the method I use in the Pinstripe Bowl going away. And because Jack kept looking over at me and saying, how are you doing this?
Yeah.
I said, well.
Yeah, I've got a little secret.
I told him ahead of time I was going to do it because I knew we had it. But that's how you do it. Monitors are behind. You can't really use that. And I know in Dallas, for example, we're in the northeast corner in the sky section, but that also means that we're up. And because we're up, we can do, I'll be able to do the game.
Steve, aren't you in Dallas way up? Isn't that skybox section like
it's way up. Yeah, but it's way up. But in other words, you'd rather be way up than at FedEx. It's the same vantage point at FedEx, except you're up. Well, right. By being up, you can see. You have a better judge of, where the ball's going, why it's going. Even when they're away from you, when a guy catches the ball at the 20-yard line, you're up. You can see he caught the ball at the 20-yard line. So you got to come up with a couple little things here and there. The interesting one is the Rose Bowl. When I did the Rose Bowl in 2009, well, you're sitting there and you're on the goal line. But you're up a little bit, so it's not that bad. So normally, over the years, broadcast booths have been moved a little further down, a little further down, a little further down. When I did the 2017 Rose Bowl, we're at the 50-yard line. I think this is the greatest thing going. They moved it. And I said to Jack, it's the same thing when I did the game at the Ravens Stadium. Ravens Stadium was one of the best vantage points I've ever had. I looked over Jack each time and I said, well, if I screw up today, it is absolutely, completely my fault.
Yep. Steve, I think Merle was giving you a big hint about something at the end of the interview. I think he really was trying to signal you something. He'd like to meet James Franklin and Patrick as well.
Oh, yeah. No, he has been... Merrill's been a very big Penn State supporter over the years.
I think he's sort of waiting for an invitation maybe to come up to one of your broadcast classes and have lunch with James or Patrick along the way. I just got that sense. I don't know what Matt thinks.
Oh, I think so, too.
We were commenting off the air that he would love to meet James Franklin.
Yeah, I could tell he would. And I'll tell James that. I'm going to see James tonight, so I'm going to mention that to him.
Yeah. That would be fun to be a fly in the wall at that time. I think the laughing would just overcome everything.
I think, they'd have a great time meeting each other, no question. So the bowl season begins tomorrow. It is Buffalo against Charlotte to get things rolling. But that's not the only game coming up tomorrow. So the bowl season starts tomorrow. Now let's get to the picks on the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
I had started this in the previous hour. Let's go all the way through. The Centennial class, I think in the end, what are they going to pick? Two coaches, three contributors, and 10 seniors. So that's 15 that end up being in this class. To go with the others that will be chosen as well. So
sure.
It's going to be a 20-man class when it's all said and done. And on this show, by the way, there's usually a lot more said than done. So the 15 chosen will be chosen January 8th, okay? And they'll be enshrined in the Hall of Fame September 16th to 19th because that is part of the 100th anniversary celebration.
So they're
That's
not
why
doing,
those dates.
Yeah, I would say they're not doing it like they normally do in the early preseason in Canton, Ohio, which is usually, early August?
Right. Yeah, the Hall of Fame class 2020 will be chosen and announced the day before the Super Bowl, like it always is. And those five modern-day selections will be enshrined in August. These 15 will be enshrined in September. So there are coaches. Two of them will be picked. Here are the finalists for the coaches. Don Coryell of the Cardinals and the Chargers. Bill Cowher of the Steelers. Tom Flores of the Raiders and the Seahawks, Mike Holmgren of the Packers and Seahawks, Jimmy Johnson of the Cowboys and Dolphins, Buddy Parker of the Chicago Cardinals, Detroit Lions, and the Steelers, Dan Reeves of the Broncos, Giants, and Falcons, and Dick Vermeil with the Eagles, Rams, and Kansas City Chiefs.
I think you're really splitting hairs among that group, Steve.
Yeah, I think Cowher's got a good chance.
Dan Reeves has a few, has a Super Bowl or two.
Yeah, he doesn't have a Super Bowl championship, though.
That's right.
He brought the Falcons before they lost to John Elway.
Yeah. Vermeil's interesting. Cowher's interesting. Coryell was an innovator.
Yeah, the famous Coryell.
Right. Jimmy Johnson is interesting, and so is Mike Holmgren. So that picking two there will be tough. Contributors, Bud Adams, who is the owner of the Houston Oilers, and then the Tennessee Titans. Ralph Hay, founder of the league. Buck O'Kilroy, scout executive with four franchises. I think most notably, I want to say, with the Patriots. Art McNally, who was the head of NFL officiating for years. Art Modell, the owner of the Browns and Ravens. Clint Murchison. Clint Murchison, the founder and owner of the Cowboys. Steve Sable.
Oh, yes.
Steve Sable should be in. I think he should be one of the three.
No question.
Seymour Sweehoff, owner and president of Elias Sports Bureau. Paul Tagliabue, NFL commissioner. And George Young, executive with three teams, most notably the Giants. Again, very interesting. But I think Sable, to me, is the one guy that I look at and say he's got to be in.
I think I'm not sure about Art Modell if you took a vote of fans.
Well, fans don't matter in this.
I know. That's the problem.
Okay. Art Modell had a great understanding for television.
Didn't he negotiate the first big contract?
Yes. Yes, and that's why his impact in the league is off the charts. But Adams was one of the original members of the Foolish Club with the AFL. Mm-hmm. I mean, he hung for many years in Houston, then he moved the team to Tennessee, became the Titans. Interesting. 10 players will be chosen. Cliff Branch. Now he's automatic. Cliff Branch makes it. Cliff Branch. Harold Carmichael, Jimbo Covert, Roger Craig, Bobby Dillon, who was a defensive back with the Packers from 52 to 59. That was one of the worst eras for the Packers, by the way. Laverne Dillwig, a wide receiver with the Milwaukee Badgers and the Packers, 26 through 34. Ox Emerson, Portsmouth Spartans, Detroit Lions, and Brooklyn Dodgers. Randy Gradishar, linebacker for the Broncos, 74 to 83. He's going to make it.
Out of Ohio State, right?
Yes. Cliff Harris.
Oh.
Safety for the Cowboys from 70 to 79. See, I think he's going to make it. You ever hear my Cliff Harris story?
No.
All right. And I got this from Jack. Cliff Harris sees Terry Bradshaw at a... They put the Steelers and Cowboys together for a golf outing for charity. I think Sheets put it together. And Bradshaw, who rarely does this stuff, went. And Cliff Harris sees him. And Cliff Harris says, "All right, I've got to talk to you." He says, "Sure, what do you want to know?" He says, "In the Super Bowl 13. He says, "The touchdown pass you threw to Lynn Swann over the middle." Yeah. Now, this is typical Cowboys, okay? Typical Cowboys. We gave you one false pre-read, and then we gave you a second false pre-read. It's always bothered me what we did to give it away. I mean, how did you read it and beat it? He says, "I don't know what you're talking about. I looked up. He's the first guy I saw, so I threw it to him." Right? And Harris muttered several expletives, turned around and said, how can you beat somebody, quote, that dumb? The bottom line is, you're trying to trick a guy who doesn't care what you're doing. He doesn't care what you're doing. You're like, hey, look, he's out there playing good old country hardball.
Yeah, a double false read. That wouldn't fool Terry Bradshaw. He wouldn't care.
He doesn't care. He looks around. He's open. I can get it there. Right now, that's my kind of guy. I love that.
Yes.
Winston Hill was a great tackle for the New York Jets and the Rams. He was on the Super Bowl winner for the Jets. Cecil Isbell, running back DB for the Packers, 38-42. Alex Karras.
I was going to say, Mongo.
58-70. He never got the off-the-hook feeling that Paul Hornung got because they were both involved in the gambling and suspended for a year. Hornung got off the hook, the golden boy image.
Sure.
Karras never did. And he probably should make it. Vern Llewellyn, running back for the Packers, 24-37, 28-32, and the New York Yankees in 27. Tommy Nobis, the original Falcon. He was the first overall pick in the draft when they entered the league in 66 after a great All-American career at Texas. Played for the Falcons from 66 to 76. Drew Pearson.
Oh, okay. That's a great one.
73-83. Just felt like in the clutch he was always there. The great Donnie Schell with the Steelers, 74-87. Duke Slater, offensive lineman, Badgers 22, Rock Island Independents 22-25, Chicago Cardinals 26-31.
That's going back to the ancient days, the first days of the league.
Yes, no doubt. The Cleveland Browns, when they were in the old All-America Conference, had Otto Graham and Marion Motley, even Don Shula. But their big-time wide receiver was a guy named Max Speedy, who played for the Browns from 46 to 52 in their 4 years in the AAFC and then their initial years in the NFL. Ed Sprinkle, linebacker, defensive lineman for the Bears from 44 to 55, and Al Wister, offensive lineman for the Eagles from 43 to 51. You guys want Harold Carmichael in?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, he's long overdue, I think. But
well, with 10 guys, he might make it.
Yeah, I think he's got a decent shot here.
I mean, he at times dominated games as a receiver.
Yeah,
just dominated. Didn't
he have 6'8"?
Yeah, didn't he have like the long for a period of time on record for longest consecutive?
He did.
Catching a pass in a game.
Receptions, yeah. And then Jerry Rice finally broke the record.
Which is not without, that's a record beater beating a record beater.
Well, let me put it this way. That's not really embarrassing.
No.
Not only that, too. You look at what Harold Carmichael did in the 1980 season alone. He was a big, big part besides Wilbur Montgomery of that Eagles offense that year that they beat the Cowboys in the AFC title game and lost to the Raiders in Super Bowl 15. He was huge that year. He was Ron Jaworski's right-hand man that year, besides having Wilburn in the backfield.
And well, not only that, but he is also the kind of guy that when they had lousy years, he was still a star.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I think Tommy Nobles will get in. He was, a middle linebacker, as I recall.
Yes. And, yes, he was.
And he dominated the game when he played. I think he had some injuries, if I'm not mistaken. But
he did.
But
he did.
Over the course of his injury-free career, he was a dominating force. Alex Karras on the defensive line for the Detroit Lions, I think, was, to use a term of today, an impact player. So lots of good names in there, but, you know, it's hard for us, Steve, to go back to the 1920 Green Bay Packers or other teams that, you know, that, boy, we don't have a history with.
Well, we will come back. We'll wrap it up in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years. All right, wrapping it up here on a Thursday. We're going to talk a little Steelers football tomorrow, huh?
That'll be good.
Yeah, looking forward to that.
Who's going to be their quarterback?
Oh, it'll be the Duck.
Yeah, they already confirmed that. Mike Tomlin confirmed that Tuesday.
Yeah. No, the Duck's going to be there. I've been so impressed by him.
Yeah, he's really thrown the ball. A lot of other teams have caught it, I think.
Yeah, it's like, oh, my goodness.
You know, remember on Saturday Night Live they had the not ready for primetime players?
Oh, yes.
The Duck is just, he may be a year or two away, I don't know, but he's not ready for primetime.
Well, and he shouldn't be.
No.
There's a reason why you keep getting released, re-signed, and so forth. And I give him credit for doing everything he can to maximize what he has, but right now it's enough to have the Steelers hang in there. He's not really winning games. He's making sure they don't lose them. And right now, that's fine.
Yeah. He reminds me of Terry Hanratty way back in the day for the Steelers.
Ooh.
Looks good with a baseball hat and a clipboard on the sidelines.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to say.
Terry Hanratty.
Yep. I think he was from Butler, Pennsylvania, so kind of a hometown boy for the Steelers.
But, yeah, out of Notre Dame.
Yep, but...
No,
exactly. The Duck will be a short-lived asterisk in the Steeler record book. In the sense that I don't think any... I'm not sure any other Steelers have thrown 4 interceptions in a game.
Let me put you this way. It's going to be very interesting to see what they do with Mason Rudolph next year. Do you keep him, or do you stick with Duck Hodges as the backup? I mean, that to me is a big question.
Trade bait, Steve. Trade bait.
But who wants them?
He still has 2 years of college eligibility. I think he could probably go back and play somewhere.
I mean, right now, Matty Ice.
Ah.
We sure about that?
Yeah.
I'll take my chances with either Duck or Mason.
Yeah. Well, that's a good thought, though.
Maybe if Bill Hillgrove needs a backup, then maybe we're talking.
You're the man.
Or Merrill. Merrill will be first, then Bill.
Well, our thanks to Merrill Reese for being on the show today.
What a great guy.
And Lou Prado. We had a lot of fun today. We're going to have more fun tomorrow. Bob, thanks for being here.
My pleasure, my good friend Steve.
Matty Ice, thanks for being here.
Absolutely. We'll do it again tomorrow.
And to the suit, go sell something.
Yes.